Around the world with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor, Chief Medical Correspondent. I'm here at ACTRIMS 2016 in New Orleans. One of the great things about being at a scientific meeting is we get to hear great oral presentations about novel ways of looking at the world of MS. As many of you know by now, the focus here has been progressive multiple sclerosis. But there's a lot we can learn from relapsing MS as well. And I'm happy to be here with Dr. Ari Green, who is an associate professor of neurology and the director of the MS and Neuroinflammatory Center at UCSF, University of California, San Francisco. Thank you so much for joining us.
Of course.
You talk about the visual system. People with MS may have questions. What do you mean by the visual system? And how can understanding that help us understand the rest of the brain? Aren't the eyes different than the brain?
Sure. So the eyes and the brain are really tied together. The only way we see is we see partially with our eyes and partially with our brain. So our eyes take in light, and they turn that light into an electrical signal that our brain then has to process and make sense out of. And so, in fact, they co-evolved in evolutionary history. They're really closely related to one another. They have the same cellular structure. They're made up of nerve cells and the supporting cells to those nerve cells that help to transmit that information from the eye to the brain.
Now, I live in the South, so the way I like to say it to my patients is the eyes really are the window to the soul. They really are the window to the brain. It's the only way that we can actually, as neurologists, see your brain by looking in the back of your eye. Now, you showed some amazing images, which were kind of like impressionist images, right, where if you squint, then it looks like a full image, but if you don't. So why is that? Why can something that looks pixelated, if you squint, you can suddenly see it better?
Sure. So that has to do with the very fact that the brain is doing the interpretation of what our eyes see. And so our brains were designed not to see things exactly as they are, but to extract relevant information as efficiently as possible from things we're looking at. And that's a good thing because it allows us to do things quickly, our brains to process information efficiently. It also is the kind of thing that a magician takes advantage of, in that our brains are not perfectly attuned to pick up every piece of information that's out there. We're actually throwing out information all the time that our eyes might see. And so the issue that highlights for us is it's a good thing also. It means that if you have injury to the visual system or injury to the brain, you can probably compensate for a very long time. Unfortunately, there's a limit to that capacity for compensation, and that might explain why people ultimately develop progressive disability and MS. There's accumulation of injury over long periods of time, and then that accumulation of injury ultimately reaches a point at which people can no longer compensate or adapt to the persistent continued injury.
In the past, we've talked to Dr. Foley about cognitive reserve. Is there something called visual reserve?
Yeah, I think there's probably a reserve in every aspect of the brain and nervous system. And the question is how much reserve there is. There may be more reserve in some systems than others. It might be why people have, although many people have visual disability with MS, that visual disability doesn't tend to be as bad as the motor disability that they have. So maybe the motor system has less reserve, and the visual system has somewhat more reserve, and cognition in some aspects may have even more reserve. The challenge for patients is obviously that the disease, MS, unfortunately, is random as to where it strikes. And some people end up with most of their disability in cognition or in vision or in balance or in areas other than motor. And so by only focusing on the motor dysfunction, we frequently have ignored the other symptoms that patients may have and the other struggles that they may live with.
So understanding the visual system better can potentially help us understand progressive MS better?
So the beauty of the visual system is because it's separate, it's anatomically separate from the rest of the brain, and it also is able to be tested with extremely high precision for function, that we can measure things at a level that we can't measure them in the rest of the nervous system. So we can't measure people's memory or cognition or even their motor function with that level of precision. And the benefit of looking at the visual system is we can use that information about progression to get information about what's happening in progression in the rest of the brain.
So the eyes might not just be the window to the soul, they might be the windows to MS as well.
Hopefully.
Now, a lot of viewers probably know your name for many reasons, but one of the reasons is that it's been well known, at least online at first where it was publicized, that you guys are studying remyelinating agents at UCSF. Now, I know there's some concern. At first, you didn't release what the name of the agent was. Then people found out. What caution do you think people should take about when they hear about it, either the one you're studying or in general, about jumping to the next thing without taking proper caution?
I think this is crucial. I mean, we have an obligation both in the scientific community, but also as patients and as a community of people who want to defeat MS, that we figure this thing out and we do it right. And the challenge comes is that we'll discover things along the way that will be steps in the right direction, and then there will be obviously new hurdles to overcome. Mm-hmm. And so right now we have completed a clinical trial with a really promising remyelinating agent. We're extremely, tremendously excited about what we see, about the capacity to complete this trial, about the results that we've generated. But we also have to have a level of caution, which is to say more has to be done for us to know what's the right agent for patients and how will we employ these medicines as effectively as possible.
So can we expect at AAN this year to hear more from you?
You will.
We will. So right there at home, you've heard it here. You can follow what we're doing at the American Academy of Neurology, and we're hopefully going to hear more of an update. Dr. Green, I want to thank you so much for having a frank discussion with us and also explaining really the both eloquent as well as profound aspects of the visual system in multiple sclerosis.
Fantastic. Thanks, Dr. Kantor. Pleasure to meet you.
And thank you for joining us.
Thank you.